Good evening, and welcome to The Chocolate Box. My name is Walter Burke, and I am a guest host this evening, sitting in for our regular host, Mr. T.X. Green. This evening, we will be speaking about the subject of prostate cancer, and specifically about the quality of life issues. I am presently the chair of a prostate cancer support group that goes by the acronym PSA, which stands for Positively Seeking Answers. The support group is based at Friendship Missionary Baptist Church at 3400 Beatty's Ford Road, Charlotte, North Carolina. We meet every second Tuesday of the month from 6:30 till about 8:30. It is a forum and a place of comfort for men that have been diagnosed and are coming through the journey of prostate cancer to gather, discuss, research, and share the life experiences of living with prostate cancer. It is a situation that you can survive with quite well. The more information you are equipped with, the better your chances are. With me this evening is also the co-chair of this group, Mr. Michael Belger. Michael and I actually met through this particular group. We are both prostate cancer survivors and are very strong advocates of spreading information and resources to provide a good base for not only the diagnosed patient, but also the community at large that is just seeking factual and cutting-edge information on treatments and services and resources. Let me introduce my guest this evening, Mr. Michael Belger.
Well, thank you, Walter. As you know, my name is Michael Belger. I'm the co-chair of the prostate cancer support group that you mentioned, PSA. I was diagnosed with prostate cancer in late 2006, around September. I went into a state of unconsciousness, you might say, and then started doing the studying and legwork around it to see exactly what this meant and what it meant to me more particularly. Brought the subject home to all my family members because they needed to be a part of this since it was a major decision. And I had my treatment then in early 2007, and I've been cancer-free, as you know, since then. But what happened with me is that after getting diagnosed and then treated, which we ask all African-American men to do, what happened to me next? Because I still found myself having issues surrounding my prostate cancer. One of them being, why did I get this cancer? So that's when I got with you, having met you at another meeting, and about 3 years ago now, we started this group. Mm-hmm. And that was one of the first questions that we had. Okay, why is it that African-American men has such a high incidence of cancer? I think you got some numbers there you want to share?
Right, I always like to share statistics, okay, on this health challenge with our audience. Let me give you a few of the baseline statistics. Every year, over 232,000 men are diagnosed with prostate cancer, and about 30,350 die. If detected early, prostate cancer is often treatable. A man with one close relative with the disease has double the risk. Two close relatives, his risk is fivefold. And with three, his chances are 97%. Prostate cancer affects one in six men. The older you are, the more at risk you become of developing prostate cancer. Under the age 40, one in 10,000 men will be diagnosed. One in 38 from the age 40 to 59 and 1 in 15 between 60 and 69. African American males are at an even greater risk, 60% higher compared to Caucasian males, and 2.5 times more likely to die of the disease. Family history is another significant risk factor. To that point, that was some of the driving motivation to start a support group, specifically based in a part of our community, okay, that has a higher concentration of African-American population, with a rate of incidence that's 60% higher than the general or main population. It's an alarm to me that we need to get out some factual, sober, and scientific information to armor our community, to try to avoid being part of the end or bad statistic. Once again, when this type of health challenge, prostate cancer, when it is screened and detected early, the chances of survival and high quality of life are increased exponentially.
Okay, and all that's good. Walter is our keeper of the statistics. I'm the more, and he has a very holistic approach, and I'm a little more insightful into, okay, so what do all those numbers mean? If all this data was available, why is it there a cure for this? Why is it that so many African-American men are ignoring the data, are unaware of this data, are not acting on this data? And that's part of the reason that our group was formed, was to start to help with that education and start a movement toward becoming the voices to get it more attention in the medical community and to get it more attention in the African-American community. Because all of that data, Walter, that you're sharing, does you no good if it's you. Because if it's you that is impacted, then it's 100%. It is 100%, and it's all represented by me. Mm-hmm. One of the data points that was shared by my doctor when I was doing the treatments and things was the survivability of it and the improvement factor, the improvement being 83% of all men recover from their treatment with no problems whatsoever and go on with their lives. Wow, I thought that was tremendous. Mm-hmm. You got my chip, let me get the treatment, mm-hmm. and which was a radical prostatectomy. Mm-hmm. Okay, I survived that, but then guess what? I think I'm in that 17% that he was talking about that still had difficulties after the treatment. Mm-hmm. And then guess what? Everybody that I have met and shared my challenge with, my journey with, is also in that 17%. So I kind of look skeptically at the data for recovery, which led to the second part. Our second reason for being, if you will, is, okay, so now you've got diagnosed. You did all the right things. You got diagnosed. You got treated. Then what happens to you? And I think that's one of my major focuses in the group. You come, and we all speak to brothers who are seeking treatment and give them some guidance, not direction, but give them a lot of information about what's available, like in that box of chocolates there you got there. You open it up, you don't know what you have there. Right. And the various treatments for prostate cancer are just like that. You open up the box, you have a menu of treatments that you can have. Which one is best for you? You and your family members, and notice the emphasis, I keep bringing your family into it because mm-hmm. this is not your thing alone, mm-hmm. to help you make that decision. Mm-hmm. But then, Walter, after you've done all that, then what happens with your quality of life mm-hmm. after that?
Mm-hmm. Well, excellent segue, because it has been a recurring discussion topic in our group, at least for the past 6 months. And we actually have a small tagline to it. It's called the then what stage. We have spent a lot of time discussing resources for diagnosis and the menu of quality treatments that are available. And keep in mind, okay, there is no one-size-fits-all treatment. Treatments are specific to patients for their family history, for their personal health data, if they have challenges with other health issues. So a diagnosed patient has to be very cognizant to align themselves with what I would consider the most relative and beneficial treatment. It has also been said that the treatment that you choose leaves you with the situation of, can I live with the possible side effects of this treatment, which is a good way of looking at it. And the reason why I say it's a good way of looking at it, because some of the very real and relative post-treatment syndromes that are experienced by men coming through the prostate journey are specifically erectile dysfunction, impotence, incontinence and urine leakage, bone health, depression, and relationship challenges. All of these are very, very real experiences that most men that we are meeting and speaking to that have come through the prostate treatment experience are grappling with one, if not a combination of some of these side effects. To that particular end, since it's been such a recurring discussion topic, we are fervently working on engaging the medical community from a few different aspects to speak directly to comprehensive and ongoing treatment of post-treatment syndrome, okay? Michael, might you build on that?
Sure, and the post-treatment syndrome is my biggest mission, is the mission that I see it. Because I've had the treatment, I think I made the right choice with all the information that I've gathered since I've been diagnosed and treated, I probably would have still made the same decision. But in the list of things that can occur to an African-American man or any man post-treatment, we're trying to find out, okay, is understanding these things one of the reasons why African-American men will not get treated? Because they're afraid of suffering from erectile dysfunction, incontinence, or any of the other five or six things that you mentioned there that could occur after your treatment? Probably so, because they will impact the way you live your life. Mm-hmm. So you have to learn to work around it. Let's start with the depression part. I had a slight depression after, of course, I was told that I had prostate cancer, you know, the big C, right. And with the P in front of it, then my whole world came to a screeching halt, but I had to keep living because mm-hmm. I wasn't ready to share that information with people. Then I brought my then fiance into the picture, and we went to visit the doctor, started hitting the internet and reading different things, reading books about it and making some choices. But then after I went through all that and had my treatment, I still was not me as I remembered me. Mm-hmm. And a depression set in for me. Mm-hmm. I found myself often sitting just staring out the window in the middle of the night because I kept it to myself. And I then would get up and go to work and all of these things as though nothing had occurred, nothing out of the ordinary had occurred, just continue on with my life. And then at night, in the evening, when the lights went out, mm-hmm. I would go into a depression about it mm-hmm. because there were certain things, the incontinence, the erectile dysfunction, and things of that type that led me into the depression and I was unable to escape it. Mm-hmm. That's when I knew I needed some help. And that's when I started seeking support groups mm-hmm. and went to a few, including the Buddy Camp one that we talked about. I did some review of Us Too and on the internet, and then got with you, met with you, and we had the conversation about starting our own group. Mm-hmm. And in our group, we found, I believe, that most of the men in the group, and that's why I say that data of 83% going on to successfully living mm-hmm. is somewhat skewed, because I refuse to believe everybody I meet is in that 17%. Mm-hmm. They all have problems of a different level with a different one of the symptoms, or as you pointed out, a combination of them. Mm-hmm. Out of the depression and being a part of this group has really helped bring me out of that, because it gave me a mission. Mm-hmm. It gave me something to do, and it made me realize it wasn't just me, because a part of that depression was, why me?
Right.
You know, here I am, because black men don't talk to each other, so I didn't know that the man sitting right next to me on the bus, in the bowling alley or whatever, also had a prostate cancer challenge, because we do it and keep our mouths shut, whereas women, they vocalize it and ask a whole lot more questions. Men, especially African-American men, where we're always taught men don't cry, we say nothing. So we don't know the huge population that really have had it until you start the conversation. And now I'm surprised. When I start the conversation, a vast majority in the room of men in the room with me have also had the challenge.
Right.
We have the erectile dysfunction challenge. And we spend in our group, as you know, Walter, a lot of time talking about that. But again, referring you to the box of chocolates,
right,
there's so many treatments. The history of having prostate cancer leading to either death or impotence is past. Men have to learn to realize you got a choice.
Right.
You can have the erectile dysfunction, and we have all kinds of things to treat that now.
Right.
If you open your minds to them, to accepting them,
right,
or you can not get treated, not have suffer from erectile dysfunction, and die.
Right. Right. And I'm glad the way you you know, touched on some of those points. One of the things that I found once I was diagnosed and treated, I met a gentleman along my research way, and he happens to live in another state, and I, you know, reached out to him, and he really made a strong point of illustrating there's a high percentage of men in the prostate journey that once they've been diagnosed, once they've been treated, they go underground. And he was the first person to plant this seed in my mind of trying to get to understand why, with such a challenging and potentially fatal health situation, would the guy sitting next to me at the bowling alley, and we may be on the same league, have been bowled together for years.
They're on the same team.
Why would it have not come out in conversation, in casual conversation? Okay, we talk about new bowling balls, okay, we talk about new shoes, we talk about new bowling alleys. But guess what? I never knew that my teammate is carrying the challenge of prostate cancer, all right? But we're learning that part of the reason that feeds this underground behavior after treatment has to do with one or a combination of some of the byproducts of it, okay? You know, the incontinence, depression, relationship challenges. I have some very sober and engaging conversations with men. I meet men that are in the midst of a healthy and flourishing relationship. And then once they're diagnosed, all of a sudden, the relationship goes through major changes. Sometimes people want to bail out because they'll say, well, you're not going to be the man that I thought you were going to be.
And you're hitting home for me with that, because my depression after I had my treatment, even though my then fiance went through it with me and knew where I was, I did the bailout thing, or I attempted to, but she wasn't having it. My depression was so great that I made the cavalier decision that I wasn't man enough for her anymore. And we, even though we were engaged to be married and were supposed to get married in 2007, later the same year after my treatment, I decided that wasn't what we were going to do. And I tried to push her away in the way men do. I couldn't say exactly why, but I just became selfish, disgruntled, pick an argument at the drop of a hat for the slightest little thing. Mm-hmm. But her understanding, and that's why I'm such a hard driver on family needs to know about what's going on, of what I was going to, in a few refusal, out and out refusal to let me do that to us. Mm-hmm. In this July, we've been married now for 3 years, and because one of the things that I suffered from was erectile dysfunction, mm-hmm. but I reached into the box and tried various treatments to our management, and like I tell the people in our group, and at the conclusion of some of the other seminars that we've had it, you may no longer be Superman, mm-hmm. but you are still going to be the man, mm-hmm. and more most importantly, you're going to be alive.
Alive, exactly, exactly, exactly. There's a wonderful study out there that's being guided by Dr. Lisa Campbell, and she is directly affiliated with Eastern Carolina University, and her study, which is very well funded and sustaining, is called the ProCare study. And Dr. Campbell, okay, has been on a trailblazing venture to, again, merge the skills and science of family counseling and personal counseling, to integrate that with the traditional medical course. As you and I know, we spent a lot of time researching the traditional medical procedures. And again, there's that concise laundry list. And they're all legitimate, and they're all very viable. And once again, they are specifically designated for particular candidates. But we all kind of get to this waterfall situation. And we get to this waterfall, and it starts to cascade into that area called then what? And again, the ProCare study is one that I've been introduced to and have found very, very well researched and beneficial, where there's a very comprehensive counseling process that helps to unpeel the layers of this journey so that we have a better understanding of why we have these suppressed feelings, why we have a certain level of challenge with things, and also additional answers to coping. All right? We hope that this conversation this evening and the conversations that we offer at our monthly meetings get to be a platform and a forum for not only men that have been diagnosed with prostate cancer, but those that just want to find out more information about the journey. And we'd like to be able to just share with you and let you know what the realistic options are. Michael?
Yeah, and in that conversation, once again, I'm asking you to reach out, because we encourage you to bring your significant other, your niece, your daughters, if any females in the group who finds that the man in the life in their life may have prostate cancer, and it could be your uncle, your father, your brother, your sister's boyfriend, whoever, to come and get the information and carry it back to them. This is not a male-exclusive fraternity. We encourage the females or other family members to come and join us in our discussions, because it's education, and that education is for everyone. And if the person involved is not to the point yet where they want to come, perhaps you can come and get enough information for them to encourage them to do so.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And once again, if I may share to the audience, this group, the Men's Prostate Cancer Support Group, Positively Seeking Answers, We meet the second Tuesday of each month, specifically in the older sanctuary building of 3301 Bates Ford Road in Charlotte, North Carolina. This particular support group falls under the umbrella of the Health and Wellness Ministries, which is guided by our parish nurse, Cassandra Harding. A telephone number that you can reach Sister Harding or any of the health ministries would be 704-391-3856. Let me repeat that. Telephone 704-391-3856. We invite any and all of our listeners this evening, and we want to encourage you to either come out and just spend a little time with us, okay, to exchange some ideas. But most of all, we'd like you to make this conversation with your family members, your neighbors, your coworkers, and your greater community. Again, this is the chocolate box, and life is like a box of chocolates, okay? We really never know what we're going to get. Before 2008, I don't think, or 2007 for Michael, I don't think we had any idea that we would be campaigning for the information related to prostate cancer. But here we are, and I think we are better men for it because, of course, they say things that don't kill you can make you stronger, okay? Well, we have definitely become stronger men behind it. We hope to share our experience, our blessing, our information, and our positive vibes with all of our neighbors and friends, and just encourage you to be proactive about your health. If you do have questions, okay, there are wonderful resources in the immediate community, all right? To that end, we thank you so much. Have a great evening. Michael, thank you.
Thank you, Walter.
Okay. Again, we're coming to you from the chocolate box. Sitting in, this is Walter Burke sitting in for TX Green, our regular host, and again, life is like a box of chocolates, okay? Michael?
Thank you. Okay, what is it?
Hey. Hey.